And at the outset, thank you, chairpersons. Thank you, Dr. Bansi Sabu, and thank you, team DiaCareCon, for having me today to speak on a little different topic of early use of CGMS for behavioral modification. So the standards of care in diabetes 2024 says that diabetes devices should be offered to people with diabetes, and CGM is one of them. The type and selection of devices should be individualized based on the person's specific needs, preferences, and the skill level. So let's start this talk on imagining a scenario. So patient enters your chamber and you kind of are having a conversation that what is your concern? And the patient is like, my sugars are uncontrolled in spite of taking care of my lifestyle. So the next question as a treating physician would be, how do you check if the lifestyle changes what you're doing are working? So we have been hearing talks on exercise, on diet, on use of technology, but how do you talk to the patient about this? So the patient is also curious enough to ask that, how can I do it, doctor? And that's when comes CGM. So RT-CGM, which is real-time CGM, has been proven to increase in time and range, reduce hypoglycemia, and improve the A1C. It's an effective tool for promoting and sustaining behavior changes in our patients with type 2 diabetes, and that's what I'm going to be discussing in the next 7 to 8 minutes. So we are dealing with a disease which is affecting millions, transcending geographical, cultural, and socio-economic boundaries, where the management is a complex interplay of medical treatment, lifestyle choices, continuous monitoring, with a later offering of being a cornerstone in effective diabetes management. So the significance of CGM becomes all the more pronounced when viewed through the lens of behavioral interventions in our patients with diabetes care. Because these interventions, which range from dietary modification and increased physical activity to medicine adherence and stress management, in this CGM has emerged as a dynamic offering immediate feedback on how specific behaviors like these lifestyle modifications can affect the blood glucose levels and help the patients. So how does CGM help? One is by enhancing self-awareness. The real-time feedback definitely helps the patient to get a good glucose level insights. He knows what is happening when he's eating a certain kind of diet or when he's exercising. He can understand his pattern and trend and thereby then, you know, modify his lifestyle. The behavior modification according to the diet management and the exercise monitoring. And definitely CGM can be a very effective educational tool. We have been hearing about all this, and it has got emotional benefits also, because as it increases the self-awareness, it lowers the anxiety and stress about the blood glucose control. Also, because the patient is well aware of how his sugar trends are behaving, it can prevent extreme glucose changes and thereby reducing the risk of complications and offering long-term health benefits. And all this amalgamates to help the patient to improve the self-management and empower the patient. When we are talking about inertia and all, we are somewhere missing out on this. We are wanting to empower the patient, where patient finds himself, you know, in control of his disease, and that will be helping him to motivate him better to take care of a chronic condition like diabetes. Also, CGM helps in personalized goal setting. So when CGM is put on a patient, when they're understanding the individual pattern and needs, they can analyze the glucose trends, whether the sugars are increasing, decreasing, what diet is helping them, and thereby they set up their glycemic targets, they modify their lifestyle, manage the diabetes, their sugars are falling, they may get in touch with the treating physician, empowering and data sharing. We had spoken about this in the earlier talk about data sharing with the doctor. When the real-time CGM data is shared with the doctor, we have applications also, then the doctor can help the patient immediately to modify the dosages, and treatment offered is better. So when we're talking about all this, are there any evidences for this topic of CGM-related behavioral changes? And when we looked up the data, there was so much data lying. Though we need more data, but a lot of publications are talking about CGM in behavior modification. So before I go in all this data, I have not put up a slide, but we have our own data with Dr. Amit Day and Dr. Rutul. The publication is in the pipeline where they have, this is going to be the first CGM data for our patients, which is AI assisted. We are looking forward, but the crux of that paper is also that CGM definitely helps in modifying the patient's management trends and helping the patient to get good glycemic control. And this is what has been seen in various studies also. So when a survey was done, when it was used, a survey or questionnaire was done to understand whether the patients using CGM could understand their food choices and physical activity, they found in the survey that it was the utility of CGM was a good behavior modification tool in our patients with diabetes and underscores the need for further research. Even in the paper which I just mentioned, they're asking for further research using CGM as a modification tool. Now, this was the CGM literature on use of real-time CGM in the behavior modification in the patients with both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. And what they saw was that in adjunct to lifestyle changes, it helps in weight reduction and potential to decrease the overall use of insulin and other medications in our patients with type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, and also in our patients with pre-diabetes. So Dr. Kirti had mentioned the huge population of pre-diabetes which we are dealing with. So if they have a CGM, they know when their sugars are behaving haywire and they take control of their diet and lifestyle, it will help them to not get converted into frank diabetes. Even leveraging continuous glucose monitoring as a catalyst for behavior, a scoping review also mentioned the same thing. It is a beneficial tool, but further research and more papers, more research is required on this for understanding the use of CGM and its implementation. Now, this was a short study which was done in youth with type 2 diabetes where they looked at patients were given a 10-day CGM and they looked at the baseline 3 to 6 month HbA1c, and what they found was that although the 10-day CGM did not impact the short-term or the long-term glycemic control in youth with diabetes, most participants reported behavioral changes and wanted to continue the CGM. So they could understand their glucose patterns better. So further research with use of CGM may clarify the potential use of CGM even in our youth with type 2 diabetes. A prospective open label randomized controlled trial when was done in poorly controlled type 2 diabetes over a period of 3 months. The intervention group was monitored with a real-time CGM. They found that there was a good reduction in the daily calorie intake, weight, body mass index, and postprandial glucose. Even when a systematic review was done with 12 clinical trials, they understood that CGM was better as compared to SMBG in understanding the trend of the glucose and thereby improving the glycemic control in our patients with diabetes. Exercise has been covered in the earlier talk, but using a CGM there also helps a patient to understand the trends of their glucose and maybe help them exercise better. Lot of real-world evidences with patients on CGM, especially type 1s, about their behavior with lowered A1C in patients where CGM helped to improve the hypoglycemia unawareness, reduce the severe episodes of hypoglycemia because patients are always scared about the hypoglycemic episodes, reduction in hospitalization due to acute complications, and improved treatment satisfaction with fewer absences. So CGM use was done in all these different classes of patients and it had shown beneficial effects. Now, this was just a wonderful thing what I came across, the application of CGM to behavioral research. So when they studied CGM for studying the basic biobehavioral processes, what they saw was externalizing scores. Now, this wasn't diabetic patients. Externalizing score is about aggressive behavior, about patient being very angry, aggressive. They saw that with the use of CGM, that externalizing scores were positively associated with percent of time spent in hyperglycemic range, negatively associated with the percent of time spent in the euglycemic range, and unrelated to the time spent in the hypoglycemic range. So again, CGM was very beneficial to understand this biobehavioral process. Again, we know that mental stress is directly related to the blood sugars going haywire. But when the CGM was studied there, they have shown that in control trials, a benefit of stress management on A1C, suggesting that when the patient was on CGM and the stress was managed well, they had better glycemic control. CGM was also studied in patients who understand the association between mood and the glycemic control, and the results showed that high blood glucose levels had a negative impact on mood, yet glucose variability was not much associated with subsequent mood ratings. And sleep hygiene, we all are talking about sleep hygiene now, and a very interesting data from CGM reported that waking up in response to an alarm clock leads to an arousal reaction that causes significant elevation in blood glucose levels, whereas compared to undisturbed sleep or being too awakened by a person does not cause that glucose spike, and this could be seen on a CGM study. So measuring the effect of behavioral interventions on glucose, the CGM was being used to investigate the glycemic effects of the pre-meal insulin bolus timings protocols in patients with type 1 diabetes and physical activity protocols in older individuals as compared to impaired glucose tolerance. So a lot of scope with CGM. It has to be utilized more. Maybe cost is a constraint, but we can still offer to our patients. It is a very good tool. The hypoglycemia is a big concern in our patients. Once a patient gets a severe hypoglycemia, they're always scared. This tool can help in reducing the fear of hypoglycemia and improving the quality of life of our patients with diabetes. So diabetes, apps, CGM, and educational interventions aimed at reducing self-management concerns and enhancing dietary self-care behavior and self-management confidence definitely helps our patient to improve their glycemic control. Also, a word about CGM can be used as in supporting remote care and telemedication. CGM comes with some challenges about accuracy concerns, cost and accessibility, data overload and management, and long-term reliability. But I'm sure with time going by, the cost concerns are going to come down with better usage of these machines and these applications. So coming back to the patient we started with, he comes back to us and you ask him, how do you feel now? And he says that there were lesser spike. When I changed the eating pattern, he started eating protein or vegetables first, and his energy levels improved, he slept much better, and what he found out was he could not tolerate chickpeas. So CGM helped him in many ways. So this is a conceptual model where precision monitoring is an amalgamation of mental health, glucose, and behavior. So proactive monitoring, early intervention, behavioral adjustment, and empowering prevention definitely will help our patient to improve their quality of life. So I end my talk saying that CGM for behavioral changes is not a reactionary device, but a prevention tool. Thank you all for your patient hearing.